Until we have gotten away from its true purpose. It has become such big business until we allow people to operate and function as long as they have something to bring to the table. People are now more concerned about recording and living in life of the rich and famous rather than knowing Jesus. For the true purpose of the church is small business, not big business. I don't know about you, but I would rather have nothing and know Jesus than to have everything and not know him. You need to confess it to me.
Confessing with your mouth, believe him in your heart. Do you know Jesus? You can know Jesus in your heart.
See all this under.
Confessing with your mouth, believe him in your heart. Do you know Jesus? You can know Jesus. In your heart, confess him with your mouth, believe him in your heart. Do you know Jesus? You can know Jesus in your heart. Confess him with your mouth, believe him in your heart. Do you know Jesus?
Yes.
In the Praise God, praise God. Good evening, everyone. Hello.
Amen.
Hello. Good evening.
Good evening.
God bless you guys. God bless.
Well, praise God. We're thankful for another day. We're thankful that God has kept us through the snowstorm. Mm. Praise God.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. So we're going to get right into the study. We have a good lesson on this evening. Praise God. Welcome, everyone, again to Iron Sharpens Iron. Just a couple things we just want to remember, keeping our phones on mute when we're not speaking, just so that we don't get the distraction in the background. And then when you're ready to speak or make your point, please unmute yourselves. We want to hear from you and hear what you have to say. Also, after 30 minutes or so, of course, it's going to log us off. And then we'll just go right back in and complete our thought for the evening and we'll pray out. Praise God. I just want to say hello to everyone. Hello, sisters. Sister Jessica looks like she's here with us. Sister Diane, Sister Yanku, Brother Lemuel. Good to see you all.
Good to see you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
You too, sister.
The snow got everybody down.
Praise
yeah,
God.
You say that again, dear.
Well, we want to again welcome you to Iron Sharpens Iron. Our mission is to collectively come together like we do for Bible study every Tuesday as we get to know each other personally, building genuine, godly relationships, because only then can we truly come to love one another as our Lord has commanded. 1 John 3:23, and this is his command, to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another. Amen. Praise God. God bless. Honey, did you want to open up in prayer or did you want me to?
I can pray.
Okay.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this evening, Father. We're thankful that you kept us and you continue to keep us, Father. We're thankful, Father, as this winter just blanketed this nation in the last couple of days, Father. You kept us safe and warm, Father. You kept us attentive. You kept us just comfortable, Father, in our minds, our bodies, and our souls, Father. So we ask today, Father, as you anoint our mouth and as you appoint our mouth, Father, to build each other up and edify us in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. God bless.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
So we've been gone for a couple of weeks. We had a family emergency last week, but we're thankful for the prayers and God worked it out. So this scripture right here, we're doing in Isaiah 5:5-7. Actually, it's a break off from this scripture right here in Isaiah 5:1-4. And we're going to just do a recap so everybody can understand that God was speaking to us in the end times in Isaiah. And what was relevant then is definitely relevant now. So just for us to do a little brief recap on it so we can refresh our mind on this, the Lord had given us a song, and I'm going to start reading it. And look at, allow your mind that's in Christ Jesus to be in you as you just take the studies and everything that Jesus has compiled on your spirit, just to understand what the Father in here in Isaiah is telling us so we can be able to understand how he's speaking to us. Now I will sing to my well-beloved a song, my beloved touching his vineyard. My well-beloved touching his vineyard, my well-beloved have a vineyard and a very fruitful hill. And he fenced it and gathered out the stones thereof and planted it with the choicest vine and built a tower in the midst of it and also made a winepress therein. And he looked that it should bring forth grapes, and it brought forth wild grapes. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge, I pray you, between me and my vineyard. What could have been done more to my vineyard that I have not done in it? Wherefore, when I looked that it should bring forth grapes, it brought forth wild grapes. This right here is powerful, saints, because God is letting us know back in Isaiah that was relevant then, is even relevant now, that he have made a vineyard and he has set us on a very fruitful hill, which is this world. And he fenced it and he put the choicest vines in it, which was his son, Christ Jesus. And he took out all the rocks and he also made a wine press on the side of it and that it should bring forth grapes, but it brought forth wild grapes. So he asked us to choose. He told us to choose Jerusalem, which is the church, and his choice plant, which is Judah. I pray you, choose between him and his vineyard. So just to sum this up, saints, God is telling us back then in Isaiah for this end time now that we have to make a choice. Are we going to choose the vineyard and stay worried about the people in this life, or stay worried about the creation that he has made, or are we going to set our eyes on the creator?
What's going on?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
So this topic right here from last week is still open. If anybody just want to expound on it, if anybody want to allow Jesus to bring more clarity to this scripture to us, feel free. Feel free. Touching his vineyard. This was an awesome song right here that the Lord gave us. This was very powerful. The Lord told us that he had made a fruitful vineyard and he fenced it and he had put a wine press in the midst of it and he fortified it. And he looked at, he thought that it was going to bring forth good fruit, good grapes, but it brought forth wild grapes. Why did it bring forth wild grapes, saints? Is it because our eyes was too busy on the creation and not on the creator?
Yeah. Well, could it be also that, you know, when we don't have any affliction, when we are completely coddled by our Father, because what he did is he loved us so much, and he still loves us, but there was no suffering there. It was complete peace, and maybe then, you know, we kind of get cocky. I don't know, we get prideful. Like, you know, we did it. We think we're the ones who achieved all these things, and get a little out of, you know, what's the right word? prideful, I guess that's the right word. And so then we become wild, we become disobedient. And so that's why God gives us trials to overcome, so that we may be pruned and be tamed, be obedient. I don't know.
I like that. I like that, Sister Yaku. That was very good.
Thank you. Before we go any further, thank you for that comment, Sister Yaku. I see a few people who do not have their mute buttons on. Could you please put your mute buttons on? Thank you.
Thank you. So I like that you said that, Yaku. Just to expound a little more on that.
Hang on, go ahead.
This is what brings us to the bottom half right here of the rest of that beloved song that the Lord gave us. Because you're right about that. We can get so caught up in creation and worshiping the things, and I'm talking about people, all these different stars, all these different things that we're idolizing, all these YouTubes and different programs on our phone that we're giving much time to, more than Jesus.
Go ahead now.
Man, it's always interesting to get a glimpse of the world through the eyes of God. You know, this chapter 5 in Isaiah, we're getting a glimpse of how God sees his people. Mm-hmm. He refers to them as a vineyard, and he talks about having planted them. And we know that in the beginning, when God first, you know, brought Israel unto himself, he plucked them up from Egypt and planted them in Israel. And when he planted them, he regarded his people as a vineyard, and he had an expectation for them. I planted you in Israel, this land that I promised to your father Abraham, and I expected you, my people Israel, to, like a vineyard, bring forth fruit. That's what his expectation was for his people. And he says, I have planted you in good soil. I have planted you in good ground. Why is it then that you are bringing forth wild grapes? That's not what I planted in you. From God's perspective, he's looking at it like, I've given you good statutes. I've given you good laws and commandments by which to govern yourself and how to represent me. And you have what no other nation on the face of the earth has. No other nation has experienced the hand of God on them the way that Israel had. No other nation had been given the oracles of God, the commandments and the statutes by which to govern their nation by the way that Israel had. They had everything that they needed to produce good fruit. And God is standing looking at them and saying, how is it that you have produced wild grapes when I planted you to produce good food? For me, it's always interesting to look at the glimpse of how God sees. You know, there's a few things in the scripture that God compares his people to. He compares them to trees. He compares us to sheep, right? He compares he identifies himself as a shepherd. And so when we see, you know, Jesus told his disciples, he says, I am the vine and you are the branches, over in John 15. And without me, you cannot bring forth good fruit. And so taking that into consideration, we get an indication that perhaps maybe we're bringing forth, or when we bring forth bad fruit or not good or wild grapes, as is described here in Isaiah, that maybe we're not being connected to the vine. Being connected to the vine, the true vine, which is Jesus Christ, can we bring forth good fruit?
Very true, brother. Thank you.
Man, that was powerful.
Yeah. Alfonso, I like that.
That was Charles. That was Charles right there. That was Charles.
Charles, okay.
Amen.
Thank you. That was good. Thank you for bringing that out.
That right there, the floor is still open, but that was just so powerful. The whole time you were speaking, just my whole insides was just, because you were hitting it dead on center, that God is telling us right here, I gave you guys a people in a fruitful hill, which is this world, and I have gave you the choice vines, which is my son, Christ Jesus. And he said he was looking forth that you would come forth and bring good grapes, but you became a wild grape. That whole thing that you touched on, champion, is what God is telling us. How is it not? How is it not that you didn't become what he expected us to become? As we get down here in the lower half of that paragraph in Isaiah 5, 5 through 7, I'm gonna just allow the floor to be open so the saints can expound a little bit more on what Charles was talking about, because that was dead on center. So I'll read the rest of this paragraph then while the Holy Spirit moves. I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. So God letting us know that since we didn't produce like he sought that we would, he said, I will tell you what I would do to my vineyard. I will take away the hedges thereof, and it shall be eaten up, and break down the walls thereof, and it shall be trodden down. And I will lay it waste, and it shall not be pruned nor digged, but it shall come up briars and thorns. And I will also command that the clouds, that they rain not upon it. For the vineyard of the host is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah his pleasant plant. And he looked for judgment, but behold oppression, and for righteousness, but behold a cry. This is powerful right here, saints, because this reminded me in Egypt when God told Israel to go and mark the doorposts with the lintels and danger would pass over them. What if I went and I just marked one of the doorposts and steps? So we got to quit running around talking about we Christians and we ain't covered the way that God has allowed us to be covered in his son. And then when something happens, then we say, oh, another Christian died or another person, because God's word don't lie. And Psalms 91, he told us he'll cover us and hide us up under his wings. So did we get off? We had to get off. It wasn't God who was off. So the hedge of protection is coming down, saints. And we have to be covered in Christ Jesus the right way so we can endure.
Thank you, Brother Derek. I think that's very true. And Brother Charles was really right on that nail. I guess he nailed it. It's, you know, another, like how he said, you know, God, I guess he used metaphors like trees, right? He also uses olive trees and also grape trees, right? Grape vines, excuse me. And then Psalms 1, what does it say? It says that we who are roots planted by the waters, which is the living waters of God, which is the word of God, you know, those who are planted by that stream, they will grow, right? They will be fruitful. So I think that is the same concept as what Brother Charles is saying about how did this, the vine become wild? How did the vine become wild? Because it was no longer part of the good vine, or how did the branch become wild? Sorry. It was no longer part. It was no longer connected to the true vine and therefore became wild.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Beautiful. Thank you, Brother Charles. Thank you, Brother Derek, for bringing this up.
Amen. So we got anybody else? Anybody else want to speak on that? That's powerful right there. I know it just got to settle, but that was deep. Because we got to look and see that the Father already prophesied this. This is in Isaiah. And look what time we're in now. This is in Isaiah. Look what time that we're in right now. We're in a time right now where people they got their eyes on everything else but Jesus. Just like this word says, on the creation instead of the creator. And now the hedge of protection and everything is going to be coming down. Are you covered the right way? Are you covered in what was intended to keep you safe? We can't be on the fence saying we're Christian one day and we want to walk in the ways of the Lord and be right. And then the next day, we're doing everything else but what Jesus tells us to do or what the Father has delegated for us to do, but then we want the same blessings and the same covering.
Yeah. In a verse where it says, I will take away your hedges and it shall be burned. And I was reading a commentary about people in the church. You know, you have, you know, a certain department, you have the deacons and the elders and just church member period.
Right.
But, you know, their purpose there is to help you grow Christianly, you know, grow in Christ. But it's just sometimes, you know, some people just don't get it. You know, they still the same way, you know, and they're there to help you, but it's going to come a time, it's going to be like they didn't did what they supposed to do to help you, but in other words, they would just give up on you and you'd be out on your own, you know. Okay. So
I hear exactly what you're saying, yeah. Camille, and that's why it's important that we plant the right way, because Jesus tells us to forgive 70 times 7. So if I'm in the ministry of being a deacon, I'm never going to give up on the flock. It's my duty to continue to pour, to continue to help, to continue to be the man that God has called me to be. Right here in Isaiah 1:2, hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord has spoken. I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me. That's important right here, because that's synonymous with this word that the Father has given us right here, is that he has nourished us and he has brought us up, and people have rebelled against him. Instead of staying connected to the vine, which is Christ, which is enabled for us to continue to be nourished, continue to be fruitful, we have parted ways and started worshiping the creation, all these different stars. We want to be like Mike. We want to be like this person and that person. But we forgot the ultimate person, which is Christ Jesus. We can't do anything without him. A lot of us should be at different places in our life, because the word that Champion just spoke, we can't do anything without Christ. We have to be connected to the vine to do anything.
I thought about, I was thinking about this scripture that came to my mind, and I just want to read this scripture, and I just thought of it where it says to work out for each of us at some point, at some time. It gets to the point where each of us, we have to work out our own salvation, work out our own salvation with fear and trembling,
right?
Which says, amen, Philippians, sister.
Philippians 2:12, wherefore my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence. Mm-hmm. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. So I'm just thinking, you know, there's a season where we come in as babes in the Lord, right. Praise God. But as time goes on, we need to be growing. And we, I mean, of course, we have those that are in leadership that should be leading us and helping us and encourage us and strengthen us. But at the same time, that responsibility is ours. Mm-hmm. That means at a particular season, we begin to grow. Right. As you come in and you seek the Lord and we read our word, you know, we own that responsibility, and we have to be, what's the word I want to use? Anyway, we're responsible. We're responsible, and we have to dig in that word for ourselves. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of times now we depend on other people spoon feeding us the word, okay? But this is a personal relationship. It's an intimate relationship. And one thing we need to remember is leaders are just leaders. Right. I mean, praise God for the leaders, because they're there to help us and guide us along the way, but only for a time. Mm-hmm. It doesn't relinquish us from our responsibility of building that relationship with Christ for ourselves. That's what I want to say.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Thank you, sister. Yeah. Amen. Mm-hmm.
Amen. Yeah. That's for
sure. You're right. You're right, amen. Michelle. Because a lot of people want you to just read a lot of books,
right?
You know,
right.
about the other person, mm-hmm. you know, and then you get to the point like, okay, it's about that person, but what about my life? You know what I'm saying?
Right. Right.
So, yeah, I see where she's coming from. Yeah, Michelle coming from. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So just a parallel scripture in the book of Acts, the Apostle Paul was, you know, in the midst of sailing to Rome in the Euroclydon storm. They were on a ship and God had came to them that night because they went and sailed out there. They wouldn't listen to Paul, but they went and sailed out there in the midst of a storm. So as God came to Paul that night and he said there would be nothing lost of the people on the ship, only the cargo. So as the boat began to toss back and forth with the wind and the sea, all the centurions got lowered the little ships off and they're ready to get down and try to rescue themselves. And the Apostle Paul made a very good, wonderful statement that unless those that abide on the ship will be saved. Unless those that abide in Christ Jesus will be saved. The Father already told us right here, the hedge of protection is coming down. So if God told Israel to go and mark the doorposts in the lintel and you didn't go do exactly what he said, now here come the stuff coming down. Here come the walls coming down, and we're about to be trodden on. The Spirit should be in you working when the Gentiles step on us, when the world come against us. Remember, the Spirit and the flesh war against each other. So if you got the Spirit of God in you and I got the flesh out here of people coming at me, then that should be working the character in you. Galatians 5:22, long suffering. The fruits of the Spirit should be working in us. And I agree with my wife. You know, she said, there's a time we come in and we're babes in the Lord. And then as we gradually get our relationship with Jesus, you know, we start to, you know, grow and accelerate in our relationship with the Lord. Everybody has to work out their own salvation with fear and trembling. And you can see people when they're working, you know, they might in this area might be this way in that area. And that's good. They're working it. But there's some people that ain't working it at all. They got much of the world in them. And if you really look closely, they ain't got nothing but Jesus just coming out their mouth.
Yes, Sister Michelle and Brother Derek, yes, I agree that we need to work out because that's what the Word of God says. And then to embellish on that more, Paul also implores us to be good Bereans in the book of Acts so that being a good Berean means, I think there were people actually called Bereans who would always double check what Paul was preaching. They would always go back to the scriptures and make sure that what he was preaching was true. And that is an example of working out our own salvation because we can't just take what people tell us, even if, you know, it is out of good intentions, because it could be not of God. And we have to read the word, you know, ourselves and Amen. Double check it. Ask the Lord, ask the Holy Spirit, is this really what you are asking, Lord? Because there are many false prophets. And so one of the ways to be working out our own salvation with fear and trembling is to really get serious with the word of God and to know it so that no man shall deceive us. For Jesus said that my people perish because of lack of knowledge. They're being deceived.
Right.
And so, I just wanted to embellish on that.
Amen.
Amen. Right, right. Yeah, there's the understanding. There's the knowledge. It ain't what we see, all those things that look good. We think it's that. But just like Yonku said, God told us my people die from lack of understanding. So just a couple of scriptures that I had that I wanted to just, and one's coming out of Isaiah 1:3-4, and it reads, the ox knoweth his owner and the ass his master's crib, but Israel does not know. My people does not consider a sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, seed of evildoers, children that are corruptors. They have forsaken the Lord. They have provoked the Holy One to Israel unto anger, and they are gone away backwards. But always remember, with all of this going on, his hand is still stretched forward for us. So there's going to be, you know, there's going to be repercussions, saints. And it's just to be real with us, real with each other, that if we partake in of Christ Jesus, and that's why God tells us in his word, you don't mock him, you just mock yourself. Because when the hedges of protections get taken away and the thorns and the briars and it don't get attended to, the only one that's going to be looking out of place is you, not God. So you only mock yourself when we sit up and play and lie and act like we're holier than thou and we ain't.
Sorry, brother, I'm talking so much here, but I also wanted to add with what you were saying about mocking ourselves. When we laugh and we mock God, we're actually mocking ourselves. Mm. There, brother, Apostle Paul is an example. Before he came to know Christ, he was called Saul, and he would mock and persecute Christians. But then what did Jesus tell him? Paul, Saul, why do you persecute me? You know, you cannot, he says, you cannot prick the thorn. And, you know, you cannot hit, there is a certain word that basically what he's saying is, you cannot mock me and not get hurt.
Right.
You know, basically repent. And so that's very true, brother. I just wanted to, back up what you were saying.
Amen. He told him, why do you kick against the prick. Pricks?
Yeah.
Amen.
That's what you were saying, Yanku. Yeah.
Amen, yeah.
Amen.
So yes, you were right, brother.
This is a good word right here. Saints, if anybody like to expound on it, we ain't gonna hold you all night because this is a good word. Let the Holy Ghost, you know, does what it has to do. But God is telling us something here. And this is back in Isaiah. So, you know, the thing I love about the Father is that he's just so masterful that he'll make a move then. And then when you get deeper in a relationship and understanding with him, it'll reach all the way to the times now. But he gave us a way. He fortified us. He looked out for our best interests. And we have to grab that lifeline through his son, Christ Jesus. We have to grab that lifeline. And we have to make ourselves available to connect with that lifeline, because that lifeline ain't only for you. That lifeline is for your kids. That lifeline is for your spouse. That lifeline is for everybody that can come into your area in your vineyard. That's the part that we don't understand. There's more people get saved out of your character and you being stand-up-ish than this you. People are going to want to know why you're different. Why you're not participating when Bobby and Johnny is. Why are you the one that's always so good and the one who got good speech and the one who get up and work every day and not scheming and scamming or getting over? People are going to look to you because that looks different from what everybody else is doing. Can you tell them Jesus? Amen.
What a wonderful day would be if we looked peculiar, because that what Jesus said, right? Mm-hmm. We are peculiar. Praise God if we come to that point.
Yes, we're peculiar people. Amen. So I had this note down here in 21 of Luke 22 to 24. And this is just Jesus, just basically, you know, reiterating right here in what the Father told us in Isaiah. And it's at 22 through 24. And for these days of vengeance, all things which are written may be fulfilled. But woe unto them that are with child and to them that give suck. In those days, for there shall be great distress in the land. Ain't that what we're going through, saints? And wrath upon this people. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword and shall be led away captive into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the days be fulfilled. So it's in God's timing, saints. We're going to go through this. And I like it because I had a prophet on the internet earlier, and we're preaching along the same lines, and it was beautiful just to hear his word today. And it was just right on this about not losing our focus. All these distractions that we got in the world going on right now to make you lose sight of Jesus so you can lose your salvation. We got to understand, yes, once saved, we are saved by Christ Jesus. But you got some stuff that you have to do. You can't get saved by Christ Jesus and go live for the devil and think you're going to go to the kingdom. But God's work is true. If he says he's going to save you, he's going to save you. So let your guard down so he can save you, so he can nourish you, so he can talk to you and teach you and show you the way unto him. Amen. Do we got any last remarks?
Yeah, I like, you know, what you're pointing out as far as, you know, what the Lord expects of us, you know, because he does have an expectation. He has invested a big deal in us by sending his son, and he has the right to expect a return on his investment. The return that he wants from us is for us to bring forth good fruit. You know, as you know, we've kind of been talking about there, that theme is, you know, interwoven all throughout the scriptures from the Old Testament right on into the New Testament, how God refers to has the expectation of his people to bring forth fruit. As we get over here into the New Testament, you know, he talks about, you know, Jesus talked about the Father being the vine dresser and him coming to his vineyard to feed from his vineyard. Mm-hmm. And he talks about every branch that is not in him, every branch that does not bring forth fruit, he takes it away. But he says every branch that does bring forth fruit, he prunes. Mm-hmm. So we see the expectation from the Father of us to bring forth fruit. And rightly so, right? Because upon, you know, accepting Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, he marks us by giving us his Spirit. And so the Spirit of God gives each and every one of us a gift.
Right.
And so he is expecting, you know, fruit to come out of the gift that he's given us.
Mm-hmm.
And so Jesus, you know, tells a parable to that end.
Praise God.
Luke 14, he says, you know, there was a certain owner who had a vineyard, and he went to go, you know, gather fruit from his vineyard, but it didn't produce no fruit.
Mm-hmm.
The servant says, I'm greatly paraphrasing right now. It's over here in Luke 14 or 13, excuse me. But he says, the servant said to the master or the owner of the vineyard, of the tree, he says, hold on, before you cut it down, let me dig around it, let me fertilize it, and if it brings forth fruit, good. If it doesn't bring forth fruit, then cut it down.
Mm.
And, there. And so, you know, the expectation of us as being people of God, because we have received the Spirit of God, which has given us a gift to bring forth fruit unto the Father, he expects us to bring forth fruit unto him. And, you know, we see what happened when Jesus came across the tree that didn't bear no fruit.
Mm.
He cursed it.
Right, right.
Walked upon it, and he went to go get fruit from it, and there was no fruit on it, and he cursed it. He cursed it because the tree was not doing what God created it to do.
Mm.
So why am I around?
Mm.
Why am I keeping around? As I was saying too, like this theme is interwoven all throughout the scriptures. You know, and early in Jesus's ministry, when John the Baptist went to go baptize, when he came to go get baptized by John the Baptist, when the Pharisees and the Sadducees came down to the Jordan River to see what John was doing, as soon as he seen them, you know, he called them a brood of vipers. But one thing in particular that he said was really interesting. He said, even now the axe is laid at the root of the tree, and every tree that does not bear good fruit shall be cut down and thrown into the fire. And so the implication is that we are to bring forth fruit unto God. But if we're not bringing forth fruit, then we might want to check our connection.
Mm. Amen.
Connect there. Right?
Yes, amen. Sir.
Or fruit.
Yes, sir.
Connected to the true vine.
Mm-hmm. I like that. That's powerful.
Praise God. Praise the Lord. I was listening to that. I praise God. Thank you for that. And then I was just thinking also about what came to my mind was the parable of the talents. Mm-hmm. And that's in Matthew 25:14-30 about the talents. The talents were given, and then you had, I don't want to read the whole thing, but the parable was the one that did not use his talent, so to speak. He didn't use his talent, but he held on to his talent. And it, you know, he was questioned about why he didn't use his talent. The others invested in their talent, but you could read it in your spare time. I don't want to take up too much time, but that's what it reminded me of when I heard Champ talking about the fruit, bearing the good fruit, our talents. We're not to just sit idle, right, you know? Yeah, so that's what I was thinking about. The same kind of this, that parable is along the same lines of what he was saying about the fruits.
Isn't it so wonderful, sister? God just, the Holy Spirit speaking to all of us in the same line, on the same line, all of us. That just proves